For our backend, basically we're using the Amazon Web Services. More specifically, we're using the Elastic Beanstalk and relational database. On Elastic Beanstalk, we're hosting a server that basically serves various endpoints for applications to communicate with the backend. It also takes care of communicating with the Google Cloud Messaging and the Apple push notification to push notifications to the Google applications for applications for Android and iOS. On the front end, we basically built an application using the Ionic framework that is built on top of our notebook. What that enables us to do is have a unified code base that's built with Angular and HTML, and that we compile down to native mobile applications that run both Android and iOS, and even Windows if you want to set that up. So one of the more important things that we want to implement was push notifications. In the past, if there was some sort of problem, some sort of vulnerability that came up while somebody was in a meeting, they wouldn't be able to find out about that until they came back to their computer and checked the bulletin board. What they want to do is, now the employees, they would be notified immediately. They basically get push notification, they're able to act upon it if they need to right away. So in the past, they went and they would look at something like that in their computer, and now instead on their phone, they were going to basically receive a notification, they would click on it, see what the notification is about, and whether or not they have to act upon it right away. And Brianna, talk about this. Yes.
Okay, so Grammar Development, we use these technical performance measures to measure whether our application was actually fulfilling the requirements given to us by Google. So the first specification we had was of three levels of access. The three levels in our application include the receiver, who can receive broadcast from the system, a sender who can actually send the broadcast, and an admin who controls what users' roles are, edit users, that sort of thing. So we have that specification as a PRV2. The second specification we have is a token due by AppSec. AppSec is a team at Disney, and we have basically passed all our code base to them for a review of whether our code meets the expectations of the company. The third specification is the application sends and receives alerts. We have also done this specification. It also delivers the push notifications that Apple was just talking about. And the last specification is support two-factor access via OAuth. So OAuth is how we're actually authenticating our users into the system. And we have so now we're going to see some actual screenshots of what our app looks like in the mobile device. So the broadcast page is what users first are brought to when they log into our system. This page is where they view what broadcast they have received from the system so far. And they're organized by color into the three alert types that they can receive. Red is for the vulnerabilities, yellow is for updates, and then the green is for general announcements. And then when the user clicks on a specific broadcast on this page, they're brought to the details, which gives them an overview of what the sender actually put in the body, whether they need to take a specific action or just more information about the alert. So on the other side, we have the sender who can send the broadcast. So this is our new broadcast page where a sender can create a new broadcast. And you give a title and both the body of the alert. And then the type is selected based off the three types of alerts they can send through the system.
And I'm Brian, by the way. And so Brianna was just heavily into the broadcast system, and now I'm just going to go over a few things, not such related, but features that Disney wanted from us to make this application sort of a one-stop shop for all their IT needs. So first we have a reporting security incident. So this is for any employees who think something fishy is going on. Basically, it gives them instructions upon what procedures they need to follow, if it's something they need to report, and worst comes to worst, there's a 1-800 phone number where they call on the Disney IT support line, and they can help you figure it out right then and there. And next, we have data classification, another view for just general employee information. This pertains to documents that the company employees will be sending to each other. You know, how far they need to go, whether it needs to be encrypted or they can send it in a text message, whatever the level of security needed there is. And this was built primarily on two principal functions. So first of which, the file was given to us as a CSV from Disney, and we sort of cleaned it up and made it fit our table and wrote a JavaScript function, which turned into an HTML5 table. And then from there, we had a regular expression filter because the table is quite long. It would be nowhere near fittable on a smartphone, so we have a nice search functionality where you can find, if you type in text documents, it'll bring it up right then and there for you. And next, we have contacts. I would say this kind of goes along with reporting an incident or just, sort of an address book functionality. So if you know exactly who you need to call, you can go and find, or even just their position. There's an expansive list of departments, their heads, and exactly what their contact information. You can contact them and that thing.
All right. So in thinking about the user experience, we realize we have three different types of alerts, and not all users necessarily are interested in all of those alert types. And so we have a subscription system, which allows them to only be notified for certain alerts. Now, just as a point of clarification, not subscribing to an alert does not mean that you're not receive it, because all alerts are in fact broadcasted to all users. It's simply about whether or not they get a tone or a buzz or a ring or something like that. And you should realize, hey, I in fact need to pull my phone out, look at it, and use them for myself, whether or not it is necessary to act on immediately. So, because in fact we're using the Ion framework, it heavily uses AngularJS. We have access to an end-to-end testing software known as ProTracker. What this does is it actually runs our application in the browser and actively interacts with it as a user would by clicking on elements, swiping, and expecting certain elements to be there based on the coder's choice. For example, I could expect to send an alert and then be able to transfer to the receiver page and then be able to look at all of the received broadcasts and see the sent broadcast in fact showed up in my inbox. And that would be an example of how it goes about setting expectation and then seeing what that expectation can impact. Now, as for future recommendations, in thinking about the user experience, we realized that some load-bearing features would be helpful in the future, specifically being able to see which things in the broadcast view have been seen or not seen. In the same way, when you go to your email box, you want to be able to know, oh, I haven't looked at these emails, I should in fact go through them. Or the flip side, I've already looked at it, this is a lower priority for me. Furthermore, we also believe that there should be a view that allows a sender to see past alerts that have been sent out as an individual. This is good for documentation and just a reminder for the sender. And then finally, this is something that has been discussed throughout the year, which is providing feedback to the sender about who has seen and who has acted upon an alert. The latter being technically challenging, but the former, about simply who has seen an alert, we decided that it was low priority simply because there was already a system in place at Disney to allow to implement it conveniently. And so we focused more on the other features that you've seen. Are there any questions?
What was the information on the computers and the login password?
So all of you can handle that by a lot, so we're not storing any passwords or information on the computer. The way we originally wanted to connect it was with the log service that Disney has. But to emulate that, we're using Outlook. So we're making just going to Outlook and figuring out the password and being seeing them without the record, not to enter the navigation.
Can you explain one more thing today? Well, I didn't quite get the difference between receiving a notification without being subscribed to that type of notification and being subscribed to it. What was the difference?
So it's more about the when you get a notification on a Facebook notification. Normally, what you would do is you go into the phone application and see what's on there, and you would receive everything on the phone. But if you're not, like, if you don't have your phone with you, you're not looking at the application, you put it down and you're being notified. You're choosing whether you're notified when you're not looking at the application or not. So when you get a ringer or a vibration, when you get that.
It reminds me of if I'm not subscribed, it's a whole lot easier to ignore.
So, again, yeah. Yeah, so you don't need
you're subscribed to newspaper because you in fact are engaged with the newspaper and thus are want to receive it.
For example, when you're on your phone, you get a push notification from when you get a message. You can choose to not get that, and you can go to that message and look whether you will always receive that message, but you don't even know when you're not subscribed to those notifications, you don't know if you received it if you're not actually looking at that application.
I can think of a better term somehow that would be
it.